Welcome back to another video tutorial with Mr. White. Today, we're going to be learning 12 different techniques that we can create in watercolor paint. The first thing we're going to do is divide our page into 12 even boxes. We're starting with a 9-inch by 12-inch piece of paper. This is watercolor specialty paper. It's heavier and absorbs more water. Now, because it's 9 inches by 12 inches, I know that I can divide that into thirds on the shorter side and quarters on the longer side and make 3-inch squares. So I'm going to measure those out, make marks along the top and bottom, making sure that I make 2 sets of marks. If I have 2 sets of marks that are at the same measurement and then I connect those dots, I know that I'm going to have even boxes. Now I'm going to label these. Don't worry if you can't keep up, you can pause. We're going to be talking about these specifically, but across the top, we're going to do a flat wash, then wet on wet, and then dry brushing, or dry on dry. We're going to do dry on wet. For the next center row, we're going to do gradient, then water droplets, plastic wrap, a wax resist. On the bottom, we're going to do some masking. We're going to lift color. We're going to salt our paper, and then we're going to soften up some edges. So that's what we're going to try. Notice, I've taped the entire perimeter of my board, or my paper rather. For this task, I'm going to need a paint palette, a kit of watercolor paints, 2 cups of clean water, a variety of brushes, as well as some paper towels. For the brushes, I'm going to want to make sure to have a couple of soft bristled brushes, 1 fan brush, 1 short, stiff bristled brush, and then 2 to 3 longer, softer bristled brushes. We're also going to want a pipette for sucking up water. It's nice to have a couple of crayons, a white and another color is ideal. And again, make sure to have a few paper towels on hand. Finally, we need some masking tape. We're going to use that for our masking section. So I'm going to put a couple of strips of that on there right now. Notice how firmly I'm pressing on the whole box. Something that we often neglect to think about when we're painting is the angle at which we hold our brush. So in this diagram, I've got a table on the bottom and a piece of paper, levitating above that table, but that is meant to look as though it is flat on the table. Now, most of your painting is going to be done at a middle, about a 45-degree angle that lets you work just with the tip of the bristles, but also press a little bit to get a wider section of bristle onto the brush. Sometimes we're going to use a very shallow angle, and you see that right here. For a shallow angle, more of the bristle touches the page at a time, and that helps us to blend our edges and lose some of the brush marks. Other times, we want a steep angle. With watercolor painting, we often use that steep angle that's a much higher tilted upward angle. We use that for aggressive tip of the bristle work, for dry brushing, for scumbling, for scratching out, and a little bit for softening up our edges. So let's get to it. For our first box, we're going to do a flat wash on wet paint on top of dry paper. So we're going to put a little bit of water into our paint palette, making sure it's clean water. Then we're going to mix a color with a paintbrush. We're going to make sure that it's nice and washed in our washing cup. Then we're going to move to our second cup of clean water, put some of that clean water into our paint palette, and mix that up. Now, the benefit to mixing and taking paint from our paint kit into our paint palette with the little cup of water there is that all of this water that I'm mixing up is going to be the same tone of paint. I'm not going to have some areas where it's really light and some areas where it's really dark. I'm going to have a little cup of water that is all the same value. That helps especially when we're doing a flat wash, but it's just good for consistency in general. So I'm going to mix up a nice amount of a fairly rich value. Then I'm going to use that, dip my brush in, and holding at a middle angle, I'm going to make a flat wash. That flat wash is going to try to cover the whole box in an even coat of paint. 45-degree angle with that brush, that's what we're seeing here. And as we press with the paint, we actually are are going to press down slightly so that not only the tip, but about the middle section of bristle is touching. And we're going to use a back and forth motion overlapping each stroke. Notice that the center of my bristle right now is covering over the spot where the tip of the bristle was on the last pass. When we're doing our flat wash, we're going to take two or even three passes going in different directions. Notice I'm slowing down here and I'm making sure that my brush covers the same area multiple times. Our goal with at least half the bristle touching is to make sure once again that we get a flat, evenly valued rectangle. I don't want some spots to be really dark and some to be really light. I want to make sure that it's all as smooth as possible. Now you can see a little bit of my lap marks here, but I've got a feeling this is going to dry pretty flat. You can tell it's all about the same color. Some spots are a little wetter than others. So I'm going to take one more pass, and then I'm going to move on. I see couple little spots I want to darken up a little more, so I'm going to make sure to do that. One last pass painting over it, and I'll call that good. For our next box, we're going to do wet on wet, and with this, I'm going to wash my brush very carefully in my washing cup. Then I'm going to use clean water after I dab it on paper towel just to make sure that my brush is very clean. I need to mix up a couple of other colors. I don't want to all do every box in purple. So this time I'm going to mix up, let's say, some green. So once again, taking some water in my palette, using a wet brush to brush on the actual paint cube itself, and mixing that palette up. Once I've got a good amount of my paint mixed, then I'm going to use the second brush, making sure it's clean, and I dip it into my clean water. Once again, this is why we have two cups of water, one to wash brushes and one for wetting the paper. Now I'm going to just paint just water on this paper. Notice I don't have huge puddles of water, but the whole thing is slick and shiny. Once I've got some water on the whole box, I have to move pretty quickly, but I'm going to paint into that box. We'll see the color moves and shifts around, and it gives us a very soft edge. That's a nice thing about wet on wet, is that we get these edges that are really gentle, that give us a soft, easy transition. If we're using multiple colors, we can have those blend together really beautifully. However, wet on wet gives us less control over the color and where the color goes or belongs, so that's something to keep in mind. We can go in and add a little bit more color into these spots, and you'll notice some different effects that will happen. But those colors do tend to bleed or move across the page. For this box, we're going to do some dry brushing. And with dry brushing, we're going to take a stiffer brush, we're going to be painting at a steeper angle, and we don't want it wet at all. This brush should be dry. We're going to take a paint that we've already wet, and we're just getting only the tip. I want to try to get as much of the paint on one side of the brush and leave the back side cleaner. And you'll see I can paint and get some very different textures. These are entirely different marks that I'm getting from, for instance, the wet on wet. And there's a difference even between holding the brush so that I use the whole width of the bristles, or when I line them all up to make a longer, thinner line. You see that right now. And one thing that we notice with dry brushing is that we can get some really great finish textures. Dry brushing is a good thing for like fur or grass or other kinds of textures where we want a distinction between different layers of a fibrous sort of material. I'm going to add in another color on here. This one is a little bit wetter because I did have to wash my brush, and then I wiped it with a paper towel. But what we see here, even with a little bit of a wetter brush, we can still capture this effect with these long lines that get thinner as they move away from their point of origin. For our final box on the top row, we're going to do some dry on wet. So that's going to be dry brushing on a wet background. So with that, once again, we're going to take some clean water and a clean paintbrush, and we're going to wet the paper. But first, we have to get our brush dry again. Now, it's hard to get a brush that was just washed dry, so I'm going to do it. I'm going to let that sit aside for a moment, and I'm going to use my fan brush. The fan brush has long bristles, and they're spread out, which is ideal for this sort of effect. Now I'm going to use one of my other softer brushes and paint clean water right on this box, making sure that I get everything to a slick level. I'm actually leaving a little extra water on the top. That's what I'm highlighting here at the back end of my paintbrush. And the bottom is damp, but not as wet. I do this so that you can see the different effect that I can get. Now, as you notice, on the bottom where it's damp, I still see each line pretty clearly, but the edges are a little bit softer and not as hard as we saw in the dry brushing on dry paper box. At the top, we get a hint of that texture, but it moves quite a lot. So, dry brushing, depending on how wet your paper is, can have a really fine, strong, sharp, noticeable texture, or it can be a little bit more diffuse. It can be really nice to layer these. Now I'm going to take another color with a fan brush, and I'm going to go side to side on here, just again trying to show what happens and how the dry brush looks. As we notice on the bottom, especially in this purple, my paper had already dried to the point that it's like dry brushing on dry paper, so that's something to keep in mind as well. If your paper dries before you can do the dry brushing, then you won't have the edges soften automatically. For our next box, we're going to do a gradient. We know a gradient is dark on one side or one corner and light in the opposite side or corner. For this, I'm going to, once again, mix up some paint. I'm going to use black this time. So I'm going to put a few drops of clean water, making sure I only got it for my clean water section. I'm going to take a paintbrush, make sure it's clean, make sure it's dry, get a little bit of clean water on there, and mix up some black paint. Once again, taking paint from the paint kit and moving it into my palette so that I can control how much value I get. But for this, I want a pretty rich black, so I'm going to double up on that. Afterward, I'm going to paint only in the far corner. This is going to be my very black section. Now, to get that smooth transition, I'm going to leave off right now, and I'm going to put some water in the middle and far opposite corner, but I'm not going to touch that water to my paint quite yet. After that, then I'm going to go back in, and using those same sort of overlapping middle angled brush marks, I'm going to drag some of my dark paint through my water and toward that opposite corner. Now we've already got the start of a nice gradient where it's dark on the far side and lighter as it goes back, but I'm just kind of losing my middle tones and my dark is all conglomerating on the left, so I'm going to adjust that a little bit. So I started by pulling the paint and then I pushed it back away. I see that I need to do a little bit more of that. Watercolor, especially on top of watered paper, is very malleable. You can move it, you can pick it up, you can remove it, you can clean up when you make a mistake pretty easily, so that's really helpful. Now, I'm going to remove some of my pigment, so I wiped my paper towel. I wiped my brush on my paper towel just now. Now I'm going to go straight from the paint kit and darken up this corner just a touch more. And then here I'm using some sort of dabbing paint brush marks, and that's helping me to mix the color a little bit more evenly, but I'm always going to come back and have my final moves be brush strokes.